valuable insights.
Are wah, I'm so eager to attend this event.
Yeah, let's get started. Good evening. It's my pleasure to extend a cheerful welcome to all of you. Our speaker for today, Dr. Gautam Chattopadhyay, is at present a senior research scientist at the Jet Propulsion Laboratory at NASA and a visiting associate in physics at California Institute of Technology. Dr. Chattopadhyay is a BE graduate in Electronics and Telecommunications Engineering from the Indian Institute of Engineering, Science and Technology, Shibpur, West Bengal, did his MS in Electrical Engineering from the University of Virginia, and his PhD in Electrical Engineering from the California Institute of Technology. He has also served as the design engineer in Tata Institute of Fundamental Research and as a senior member of the research staff at California Institute of Technology. Not just that, Dr. Gautam Chattopadhyay is also an IEEE fellow and is a general chair of the IEEE International Microwave and RF Conference. Dr. Chattopadhyay is a recipient of many prestigious awards, such as the JPL Mariner Award, a five-time awardee of the NASA Group Achievement Award, IEEE Distinguished Microwave Lecturer Award, IEEE Transactions on Terahertz Science and Technology Best Paper Award, IETE Professor SN Mitra Memorial Award, among many others. At present, Dr. Chattopadhyay is working on instruments at terahertz frequencies for astrophysics, planetary, and earth sciences, and also developing the world's first terahertz radar for standoff imaging applications as a senior scientist in the Jet Propulsion Laboratory, NASA. We at IEEE BMS ITNM are very fortunate to have you among us today, sir. Thank you very much for agreeing to spend your precious time with us despite your busy schedule. We warm-heartedly welcome you today to the Roadmap to NASA webinar and are eagerly waiting to receive wonderful insights and guidance from you, sir. Amara apna ke shogoto janai. The stage is all now yours.
Thank you.
Yours now, sir.
Thank you so much. And thank you for the last sentence in Bengali. I speak Bengali at home. So I'm really happy to be here amongst you all. It's early morning here. But when Likhita contacted me and asked me to talk to you all, I accepted immediately. The reason is that I feel that young people like you are the future for IEEE as well as for technology and science. What we do at NASA is actually related to science. Many of you might think that, okay, what does NASA do? Mostly, develop cool technologies. That is not necessarily true, because all the technology that we develop at NASA is actually driven by science. So science plays a big, very big role. One of the things that actually I am currently working on, and that is the main goal of NASA, is to find out, are we alone in this universe? Is there life anywhere else outside our own planet Earth? So how exciting is that? So suppose, just to be sure, I just wanted to let you all know that we have not found any sign of life anywhere. Whatever you read in newspapers or in YouTube, so don't believe them. We have not found any aliens anywhere. Think about it, that you develop some technologies and that technology goes into space, and maybe one day it will discover existence of life somewhere else. How cool that is. So I am always excited to go back to work. Of course, currently we are all working from home because of the COVID situation. However, NASA is a wonderful place to work at. Sometimes I actually pinch myself and see that, am I dreaming or it's real that I'm working here? And people who are surrounding me are extremely smart. So I always tell people that if you want to be successful in your life, what you do is surround yourself with people who are smarter than you. And that is the key to success. So that's what I have done. I have been very lucky to do that. So I'm looking forward to interacting with you, answering your questions, whatever you have. Not that I know the answers, but what happens is when we have question and answer sessions, as collectively, we actually can come up with some sort of, you know, agreement and some sort of answer. So that is the idea of this event. So I'm looking forward to your questions. Thank you.
That was a wonderful talk, sir. Now let's move on to the question and answer session. We have a few questions prepared by our team and also questions submitted by the participants in the forms. Meanwhile, if the audience has any other questions, you can put it up in the chat box. So sir, are you ready to take up the questions?
Yes, go ahead, please.
Okay, let's start. Okay, sir, so how and when did you get an interest in space and research?
Okay, very good question. So let me tell you a little bit about my life story then. Maybe that it will give you a little you know, better insight into how I got interested in space and research and all these areas. So I grew up in the outskirts of Kolkata. There is a small village called Novogram. So I always tell people my journey from Novogram to NASA. So there I grew up in a very poor family. We are six brothers and sisters. I am the fourth one. I have three elder sisters. I'm the fourth one. And then I have another brother and one more sister. And my parents were really poor. You know, this is, I won't tell even not middle, lower middle class. The correct terminology will be really poor. We did not have two meals a day at home, proper meals a day. We had one room house. And so all of us grew up there. And what happens is sometimes when you are hungry and go to bed, then you cannot fall asleep. And then, lying down on the bed, I used to dream. One thing for people like us, who I'm sure there are many other, I'm not the only one around the globe who went through this kind of situation, that one thing that when you dream, it doesn't cost anything. So I used to dream big. I used to look in the roof and then start thinking about, at that time, a lot of excitement was going on about NASA. And also I had some kind of fascination for one university called Caltech. I don't know why, because I think I read an article about, about Feynman, Richard Feynman. Richard Feynman was a great physicist from Caltech. And I read an article and then I got fascinated about California Institute of Technology, Caltech. And so there, so my parents always told us that people like us who are poor, only way for us to be successful is to work hard. So I still believe that, because there is no alternative to hard work. And then, my brother and I, we went to an engineering college, currently that is known as Indian Institute of Engineering Science and Technology. It used to be called a BE college, Bengal Engineering College. That is the second oldest engineering college in India, according to, Wikipedia and others, that the oldest engineering college was Roorkee. And our college was 6 months, younger than that. So I went there, and then, I had this kind of, as I told you, fast. I had to take up a job after my undergraduate because of the financial situation. I joined TIFR, Tata Institute of Fundamental Research. They were building a telescope, a radio telescope. Many of you know it is in Pune, called GMRT, Giant Meter Wave Radio Telescope. And there I met Professor Jayant Nalikar. Many of you know Professor Jayant Nalikar is an amazing astrophysicist. And then Professor Gobind Swarup, he is an FRS, and he actually is considered the godfather of Indian radio astronomy. I got to know them and started working with them, and that opened my eyes about research and about astronomy, about space research and everything. And from there, I thought that I need more education. So I applied for my graduate studies. I came to US. First, I came to Virginia, University of Virginia. There I did my master's. And then I was brave or stupid, I don't know. I told my master's thesis advisor that I want to go for PhD, but I will apply to three universities. If I get there, I'll go there. Otherwise, I'll stay back and do PhD with you. So he was nice. So he said, okay, go for it. So I applied to Caltech, California Institute of Technology, MIT, Massachusetts Institute of Technology, and University of California at Berkeley. And to my utter surprise, I actually got admission to all three. And then I came here to Caltech to do my PhD. And Caltech is an amazing university. It's a very small university, only 2,000 students. Of that, 900 are undergraduate students and 1,100 graduate students. But Caltech produced 42 Nobel Prizes. So when I used to walk around, you know, I used to see people who are walking by me on Nobel Prize winners. So it's kind of, you know, unreal feeling. And on top of that, my thesis advisor was in the physics department, though I was doing my PhD in electrical engineering. And every winter, you know, next to my office is to be in a couple of doors from my office is to be, you know, Stephen Hawking is to come and sit there every winter. And so I got to know him. I used to chat with him and to meet him, all these famous physics professors used to come and meet him. And then I used to talk to them. One of them was, you know, Kip Thorne. Kip Thorne got Nobel Prize for physics in 2017 for detecting gravitational waves for the first time. So that actually, that research environment that was really amazing. And then I was thinking what to do after my PhD, and I was writing my thesis up. And then one day I got a call from NASA saying that, you know, they want me to go and give an interview. Luckily at that time, there was no video phone. Otherwise they would have seen me that I'm jumping up and down because that was kind of my dream. So I went over there for an interview, and, you know, interviews here is very different. They ask you to give a talk, and then we spend the whole day going around meeting people because they want to see. They won't send you to the blackboard or whiteboard asking you to solve any questions. They want to see how you think, how you interact with people. I'll talk more about it, the importance of, you know, this meeting people, talking to them, you know, in a group, working in a group is so important because the problems that we are trying to solve is so complex that it is not really easy for one individual to solve. So we'll have to always work in a group. And then I accepted the offer, and then I joined NASA. And from there, you know, I love every moment of it because what we do is really important and amazing. So that's how my interests, I know I took a lot of time describing all this, but that is how I actually got interested in science, technology, space science, in that way.
Thank you, sir. That was very inspirational. So moving on to the next question, can you describe a day at work at NASA?
Okay, currently what I'm working on, you know, I have been working, what I do is, I am in a kind of a bridge between the scientists and, you know, and technology, because it turns out that scientists and engineers, we don't really speak the same language always, because as I was saying that everything at NASA that we do is driven by science. So how, what happens is it starts from asking a big science question. Suppose I tell you that, are we alone in this universe? So this is the big science question we are trying to answer. Then the next question will be, to actually prove that, to answer that question, what kind of measurements you'll have to do? And then the question will come, to do that kind of measurement, what kind of instruments you'll have to develop? And from there, and then when you are thinking about instrument, then you'll have to say, do you have all the necessary technologies that are needed to develop these kind of instruments? And that's how the ball rolls. So I am currently, I have been working on, you know, on different areas, astrophysics, planetary science, because when you're building an instrument, that instrument can be applicable to astrophysics, can be planetary science, or even earth science, that is our atmospheric science. So what I currently, one of the very cool project I am doing is I'm building a small shoebox size CubeSat-based instrument to actually do measurements on a comet to see that did water on Earth came from comets. Because when our Earth was created, there was no water. So scientists believe that the comets are small and though asteroids, they brought water to Earth. So to prove that, you know, there are only very few measurements have been done so far. So to do that, I am building a very cool instrument, very small, very low power, and LOMAs, because when you are building instrument for space, one of the key important issue is that you cannot have a lot of power, because we cannot generate a huge amount of power on these small satellites. So how can you make it small? How can you be highly integrated? That is one of the area I'm working on. I've been involved in Mars rover. You all know Mars rover Curiosity. You know that we have this Perseverance rover on its way to Mars, and then Ingenuity helicopter even on that. So I have been working on some astrophysics, currently doing some astrophysics instrumentation to find out, you know, how the stars and galaxies are formed. Because every day we have so much of unknown out there about all this. So we are trying to find out, you know, how new stars are formed, how new galaxies are formed. So among that also, I am working on an instrumentation for finding out about climate change. You all know that climate change is a big issue currently. So, and it turns out all the pollutants that they actually travel through the upper troposphere. Suppose you are burning some wood currently in Bangalore, and it turns out that only in a couple of days, the pollutant that is being generated out of that will show up in Los Angeles area, and they will transport through the upper troposphere. So how that transportation works, you know, what we can do to mitigate these issues. So we are developing instrumentation for that. And on top of, you mentioned that I have developed some radar instruments for NASA applications. However, Department of Homeland Security, they came to us, actually built some imaging radar for security applications as well. So to tell that I have been really busy, and we always develop new technologies to build these instruments. And so I do detectors, antennas, and entire instruments, and connect that to the science as well.
Thank you, sir. That was really wonderful. So the next question is, where do you see space research in the coming years, and what do you think will be the next big thing?
So always the good question is, what is the next big thing, right? So next big thing is a lot of unknowns in terms of next big thing. It is always difficult to predict the future. However, as we are seeing that, you know, climate change is a big thing that you all know around the globe. So we'll have to really, really pay attention to that and to instrumentation for that. As for NASA and space science area, then there are a lot of big things is that we are going back to moon, right? So NASA has started a project called Artemis. So where, you know, currently, when you go to moon, you just have to have a single mission that goes, you know, there is a lander, you have to land there. However, we want to build something like the ISS, International Space Station, that we have for Earth. If you can, Artemis is a kind of a gateway to Moon. So if you have this Artemis project like the ISS, then in future, what we plan to do is, suppose that is an astronaut is planning to go there, then you will send people to Artemis, and from there they can. Are out there that we are trying to solve. If you have been following the news recently, you must have seen that, you know, we have one group has detected phosphine on the atmosphere of Venus, and scientists believe that, you know, that is more of a biotic in nature, in the sense some form of life must have generating that phosphine. So we don't know. So there will be, you know, I do know, because many of you are in Bangalore, so I just want to let you know that ISRO has a plan to call a mission to Venus called Shukrayan. And actually we are involved with ISRO in that work as well. So it will be very interesting to go to Venus, because Venus is such an inhospitable environment. But how can life exist there? Surface it cannot, because the temperature is about 400, 500 degrees centigrade. So how can anything survive there? But in the upper atmosphere, it is much cooler. So we are actually building, these are the next big things in terms of what is happening. And on top of that, you know that, you know, SpaceX and other, you know, Blue Origin and others, they are developing, making a lot of progress. So maybe space tourism, will be something that is coming up. So these are the thing that is happening in near future.
Thank you, sir. That was very insightful. Next, one of the participant asks, Nitin, I am a mechatronics engineering student. How can I make my career in NASA as a robotics engineer?
Okay, so let me then answer in the more general way, because I think many of you will be asking the similar question. Someone is mechatronics, someone is maybe not in mechatronics, in somewhere else, they might be asking the same question. So to answer that, you know, NASA, we need people from all disciplines. If you think about it, because the problem that we are trying to solve, it is not related to just electrical engineer, mechanical engineer, thermal engineer. We need across the board. We need physicists, chemists, we need biologists, we need, you know, electrical engineers, we need, thermal engineers, we need, fluid dynamics engineer. All kinds of field are actually all come together in NASA because we are trying to solve all these complex problems. So, you know, do not think that, okay, if I study this particular subject, I have a better chance of coming to NASA. That is not true. My suggestion to you all will be that whatever you are studying, whatever is your passion, follow your passion. That, you know, don't study thinking that, okay, if I do this, it will help me there. I don't think that is actually the right approach. Instead, if you think this is what I like doing, and if you study that, what will happen is you are going to put your heart and soul. You know, I won't have to tell you, you all know, you are all student. You like something and you actually end up spending so much more time on that. And others will say, why are you spending time there? Your parents will be saying, you know, you study something else. So that happens on a regular basis. But you'll realize that once you are following your passion, you are understanding that much, much better. So my suggestion is always to everyone, when you are studying something, trying to understand the basics. How are these things working? Don't go after mark. Of course, you know, our system is set up in a way that all this selection, everything is done on the basis of marks. But you know, that is not very helpful but my point is, if you understand what is going on, the fundamentals very well, it will show up. Because when we hire people at NASA, right? Okay, we see the marks are there, but we generally do not pay too much attention to that. So when someone is coming, we don't send people to solve equations on the blackboard. The reason is that, okay, whatever you know, but when I talk to you, when I'm talking to you in general things, the way you respond, that shows how much you know. It is very difficult. You can give a lot of BS, people do. However, it doesn't take much time for people like us to figure out who actually really understands something and who is just talking. So if you know the fundamentals, you are understanding the basics, it will show up. And trust me, that will really help you to get. We have people from, you know, who does not, in the look at the transcripts, not good at all, but they are really great researchers and we have hired them because we do not look at your transcripts, to be honest. We talk to you and that way, we hire people. That's why I'm saying that it is not that you pure mechatronics, how do I come to NASA? Whatever you are studying, study well, do well. I know that this question is come up next, most probably, that how do you come to NASA? Next question will be that, right? So to preemptively, I can answer that what you'll have to do is, you know, that various way one can. It is very difficult to get into NASA directly from India or other countries for a job because, you know, we won't be able to interview you. You know, this you're always face-to-face sitting, face-to-face. This is the most, fruitful way to actually understand if someone, you know, good or not. So you won't be able to do that. So we generally don't hire directly people from outside the country as an employee. However, the best way to do is, if you want to come for a higher studies in US, your master's or PhD. I will encourage everyone to think about that. And currently, because of this COVID situation, because job market is really bad, you should all think about getting additional skills like for higher studies. That will be the right if you can. Of course, a lot of people have financial constraints, but still strive for that. And if you come for higher studies here, then you can apply for, if you're doing PhD, you can apply for a postdoctoral position. NASA has a great postdoctoral program called NPP, NASA Postdoctoral Program. And once they come here, of course, it's very competitive, but if when the people come for NPP through postdoctoral program, many of them, we hire them. The reason is we have already know how good that person is, then why should we let them go? So I have a lot of postdocs and many of them we have hired. Some of them went back to Europe or other places where they want to go back, but many of them we actually kept. And the second way is that if you are doing your master, suppose in the US, then you can apply for a job. And then if you are good enough, then you'll be selected. So this is the best possible way to actually get a job in NASA. However, I should also argue to actually look into ISRO, because ISRO is doing really well. So you should not just think about for space, about NASA. You should look into ISRO as well.
Thank you, sir. That was very insightful. I'm sure many of them got their doubts cleared. Next, Tushar asks, since you have been using terahertz frequency, so I am presuming you must be using optical frequency. So what are the kind of optical devices that NASA is using currently? And can you suggest some future devices and application in the optical domain you people are looking for?
So to answer first your question, that actually terahertz frequency is somewhere in between microwave and optical. So at terahertz, you can use both optical technologies as well as microwave technologies. So we use both electronic and optical, both. It's not necessarily just we do optical. So all these devices, our focus has been more towards coming from the lower frequency side. Basically, if you're coming from microwave and you're coming towards terahertz, then you are using electronic devices, right? Semiconductor devices and, 3-5 semiconductor, gallium arsenide, indium phosphide, that kind of, because they have higher mobility, so they work better at higher frequencies instead of silicon. Because silicon, you all know that all your phone, all your smartphone has mostly silicon technology. So, but that does not really work that well at higher frequencies, but we can come from optical side as well. So we can mix two optical signals in a photomixer that you are asking about, the devices. So you can use the photomixer to use two lasers who are at optical frequency and then mix them down and bring it down to a terahertz frequency, and then you can work with them. So we use both. That's why there is a term that is very regularly used at terahertz called quasi-optical. So you can use at terahertz frequencies, optical techniques like lenses, mirrors, everything that is used optical, but that can be done at terahertz frequencies using microwave technology. So it is a kind of amalgamation of both these worlds. So that means you have your more opportunities for research because you are coming from both ends.
Thank you, sir. Next, Parinita asks, when a student is looking to join a master's program in space technology, what are the important factors to consider for selecting the university?
Okay, that's up to, again, that's why actually I mentioned at the beginning, you should follow what you want to do. So when you are choosing a university, that's what you want to do master's at, there are a couple of things you should do. First of all, you should look at, what exactly you want to do. You have to ask that question to yourself. First question you should ask, what is my short-term and long-term plan? You should, irrespective of whether you are going for master's, whether you're going for PhD, or you're going for a job, anything, you should ask this question. Generally, we don't do that, right? Sit down and ask this question to yourself. What exactly do I want to do in life? What are my short-term next 5 years goal? What is my next 25 years goal? So if I ask you all, where do you want to see yourself 20 years down the line? It is highly possible that you won't be, what you are saying now will be, your life will be completely different. That is fine. But at least if you can tell that, this is where I want to see myself down 20 years from now, or this is where I want to see 5 years from now, this question you should ask. And then that will tell you, you know, what where your passion lies. And once you identify that, then look at the universities where those fields, there are professors who are working actively in that those areas. And then, you know, you choose them, you write to some of these professors, you will say that, okay, they might not respond. Yes, many of them are not going to respond, but maybe one or two will. And then you ask them questions, ask them, are they going to take any new students for master's or PhD or for some research? Get some kind of background information about that and see what kind of facilities are there in that university. Because you might land up somewhere thinking that, oh, this is a great place, but if they don't have good laboratory facilities, like terahertz we were talking about, right? Terahertz needs very specific lab equipment. If they know you want to work in terahertz, but if the university does not have that kind of lab facilities, what are you going to do? You'll be then doing only on paper work. So that is not very exciting, right? So look into all those and write to some of these places and then decide where you want to apply.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. So moving on to the next question, Mukesh P asks, how are you utilizing artificial intelligence and machine learning to aid in research in NASA?
Okay, that is true. You know, AI and ML nowadays is everywhere. If you open any newspaper, anything, you are seeing that a lot. And it's very important area because there is a growing area of research. The reason is there's so much of data available, right? Machine learning thing, you need existing data for your machine to be more useful, right? So these are being used in NASA as well as, you know, all across the board in a very big way. So if you have interest in that area, you should study up, you should see, because there will be a lot of opportunities to work in that area, because this is just at the, these areas are just coming up, you know, there's not a lot of work has been done yet. So there are a lot of opportunities to contribute more in machine learning as well as AI.
Okay, sir. So the next question is, can you give an insight about your IEEE journey?
Oh, yes. So I should have said before, if you are not an IEEE member, you should become an IEEE member. There are a lot of advantages to become an IEEE member. So when I was growing up in India, I did not know anything about IEEE, because there are not many IEEE branches where they're not IEEE, the sections were there. So I didn't know. So, but when I came for my master's, I became an IEEE member immediately. And since then, first I was a student member, and then I became a regular member after I actually graduated and then took up a job. Then I became a senior member, and then I became IEEE fellow. IEEE fellow is the highest recognition that you can get, and is a very, very humbling experience, because only 0.1% of all IEEE members can be at one time can be fellow. So this is a very, very, selective process. But you should also, that IEEE, there are a lot of societies. So you can become IEEE member on top of that, in area of research that you do, accordingly, you should become a society member as well. There is very minimal fee from India, actually is very, very low, those fees. So I am not only IEEE member, I am also a society members of MTT Society, Microwave Theory and Technique Society, and also Antennas and Propagation Society. There are many societies are out there. You should become a member. So what does IEEE provide you, right? It provides you this kind of platform. This webinar that is being organized today, the interaction that we are having with you all, actually coming under the leadership of IEEE, because they bring people together. What it allows you beyond the pandemic, when the pandemic is gone, you will be able to actually have meet in person. Networking is one of the most important area where for your professional life, that will really help, because you need to know, if you know people, you can just write an email saying, hey, I need some information, can you help me? And then that person says, okay, I know someone who is working in that area. So this brings professionals together under an umbrella where you can actually interact And also, of course, you when you become an IEEE member, you have access to journals, you have access to a lot of webinars nowadays. You know, because of pandemic, webinars are becoming a big issue. And when you go for a conference, if you're an IEEE member, you have reduced registration rates. You have a lot of other perks that you get. So I became IEEE member, as I said, as a student, and then I continued. And then through that, you know, once you get a fellow and all, that gives you a lot of visibility in your professional work as well. Because maybe, you know, you guys wouldn't have called me if I was not an IEEE fellow, who knows? So that, you know, those are the different parts that you get.
Okay, thank you, sir. That was very insightful. So moving on to the next question, how should undergraduate student develop research aptitude for innovation according to you?
You know, it is not only true for undergraduate student, it should be the innovation and the research idea should be part of the school curriculum. That's what I think, because I have seen in the US, you must have heard a lot of bad things about US, you know, school education and all. People talk about it, but you know, my experience has been that here it is done in a very different way, because our approach has been more in India traditionally, and I'm sure things are changing, that we more focus more on the bookish kind of education, that okay, teacher comes and talks about what the textbook, what is there. But if there is a project-based education, that if you are telling, suppose we are teaching Newton laws of physics, but then people are doing experiments, students are doing experiments, and then you are given a small project to work on something, then you'll have to think. You know, to think, how can I do this? So, as I was saying, that when you go to undergraduate level, so you know, nowadays there are a lot of opportunities to do projects on your own. So even if suppose your university, your college, then they do not provide that kind of facility, they do not provide that kind of opportunities, few of your friends can get together, you know, and say, okay, let's do a brainstorming thing and let's do a project. And you can buy small components, not that expensive components on the internet, put them together, come up with an idea, do a design, put them together, test it. It might not work, but the journey itself is so much more important than actually the where you reach. I always say that. So that in that process, the insight that you will get, you know, a lot of places nowadays, there are robotic competition. So you can do, you know, small things. You won't have to do something really big, but small things, if you can think of trying to solve everyday problem, then you will find that you are learning so much. And that's how your innovation comes. Innovation is a term that people use very loosely, but innovation does not happen in a way that one morning you wake up and say, let's go and innovate something. You do not innovate that way. Innovation comes always when you are trying to solve the problem. Because when we try to build something, we are trying to solve a problem, and we find that existing technologies are not solving that problem. Then you'll have to really scratch your head and come up with a new idea, try it out. You know, many of them are not going to work, because we have so many ideas, but it turns out that many of them do not work, and that is fine. You know, failure is okay, but you'll come up with one that works, and that's the excitement that you get out of that is just mind-blowing.
Thank you, sir. That was very interesting. Another interesting question from a participant, Rocky Rock. Do NASA really believe in UFOs? We know to travel from one galaxy to another consumes a lot of fuel, which is practically possible, but for our mankind to find about it would get a generation of time to develop such technology. Suppose if the theory says UFOs travel through any wormhole, does NASA actually hide something to the world if they really found a wormhole in our solar system or nearby?
Okay, so before I answer your question, let me actually answer maybe many other questions will be coming same way, UFOs and then next will be alien, then next will be fake landing on moon, then will be Area 51. I know these are the standard questions of all of you. Instead of focusing on real things, you know, sometimes we get those attracts more. First of all, UFO, what are UFOs? We unidentified. If you actually look into it, many of them that have been unidentified before, you can explain with science or with our current knowledge, those phenomena. So it is not necessarily that there is something sinister about them and all. So first of all, NASA is not hiding anything from you. If we know something, we write, we'll tell you. And so, you know, we have not found any wormhole that you can travel, time travel. That is not the case. And in terms of, you know, intergalactic travel, so we have not done any intergalactic travel. We have traveled only within our own galaxy, only a little bit, not too far. The farthest and human-made object that has gone is Voyager. Voyager just left our solar system. So it has not gone far. If you think about it, in our galaxy, Milky Way galaxy, there are 100 billion stars, 100 billion, and our sun is one of them. We have just gone out of that sun, influence of that sun, outside that, you know, the gravitational pull of that. So we have not gone far because we do not have the technology to actually go far as very fast. So whatever we are learning, so that's what we are talking with innovation just in the previous question, that's where the innovation comes. Then you have to think here, what can we learn sitting here? What can we learn going little bit outside our environment? What kind of technology that we need to do that? So because we cannot travel. Like I was telling you, we are looking for life and we are finding many planets called exoplanets. These are planets around other stars, which may be habitable in the sense that maybe there could be life there. You know, they're in the habitable zone. What are habitable zone? Because when you're looking for life, we are looking for life of that we know, carbon-based life. They need atoms like we call chonops, carbon, hydrogen, nitrogen, oxygen, phosphor, as well and sulfur. These are the building blocks of life. We are looking for those. And when we say when you find a new planet, we call it the habitable zone because they need life that we know. They need kind of water, oxygen. Then we are looking for the planets where the temperature is such that water can exist in liquid form on the surface. So we call them in the habitable zone. And we are looking for those. And we actually found many of them, but they are hundreds of light years away. One of them is 40 light years away. You know how much time it will take to go to a planet which is 40 light years away with current technology? About 40 million years. So we can never go there and actually do in our lifetime to go and explore. So we'll have to develop technologies so that from space or from art, we can actually look into that and learn as much as we can, because those are not going to happen. So we have not done any intergalactic travel that you see only in movies.
Yes, sir. Thank you. That was interesting. Next, Harsha asks, what did you spend most of your time on during BE, considering currently I'm in B.
Okay, so what did I do? I actually spent my time talking to friends. That's what I did mostly during my B days, to be honest. This is not important to think about that. I love to study this, I love to study that. I always had tried to understand, you know, whatever subject I was studying. I used to go to class every day. I never missed class. And people used to say, why do you go? You know, maybe the teacher is not good, blah, blah, all this stuff. But, you know, when I go there, I used to, you know, listen. I try to understand, you know, what is going on and take some notes and all. During my time, there was no internet. Internet was not invented at the time. So I'm talking about, you know, late 80s. So there was no Google search that you can do. So you had to read real books. You know, I know that is kind of something, you know, unreal for many of you. But yes, that's what I feel very old in that way. So we used to do that. So, but, you know, as I said, the basics are very important. If you have to try to understand the basics, that's what I did. And from there, that's why maybe I got the job in TIFR, because maybe I did well in my interview. I don't know. My understanding, I don't know anything. Even now I feel there's so much to learn. I know so little we know. And one of the quote I really believe in that, more you learn, more you know how less you know. You know, that is very true, because we really know very, very little, and there's so much more to learn. And that's why if you focus on that when you are doing an undergraduate, whatever subject you're studying, you are studying DSP, let's say digital signal processing, you're studying, you know, some microwave engineering, you're studying AI, you know, a lot of AI and all, try to get the, you know, fundamental in the depth of it, try to go down as much as you can, then you will be able to see the beauty of it.
Thank you, sir. This is a very interesting and recent question. Rohit asks, what do you got to say about the metal monolithic that is found recently, got vanished and appeared at some other place?
NASA did not do that. That's what I can say. So it is, I know it has been happening. It started in Utah, right? You know, somewhere in the middle of that. So it seems there are some artists, they used to do that. At least that one name. It came out that they used to do that and put some of these monoliths and some of this art in the middle of nowhere, and people find it. And you know that has been removed, right? From Utah, it has been removed. That one has come up in Romania now, and it is going on. So it is catching on. So maybe you also should think about it. Maybe make some engineering stuff and put in the middle of somewhere. That would be a good project to do.
Okay, sir, so moving on to the next question. Rubini asks, what major functional differences do you find among NASA, ISRO, and SpaceX?
Can you repeat the question? I didn't understand.
What major functional differences do you find among NASA, ISRO, and SpaceX?
Okay. Oh, okay. The question was that, you know, what are the major functional differences we see about SpaceX, NASA, and ISRO? Thing is that SpaceX has a very different, idea of space exploration. NASA, ISRO, for NASA, we mostly do science. As I said at the beginning, our thing is to explore science, and whatever thing that we need to develop. But SpaceX is a company. Their main aim is to develop this space technology so that eventually they can take people to space. And, you know, they can make some money in the process as well. But they're doing really well. If you NASA has, you know, that actually NASA works with SpaceX very closely. You know, most of the money that SpaceX is getting, that is getting from NASA to build some of these and do some of this work. So it is very vital that the private organization, private companies get involved in this area, because, you know, private people can, you know, can do a lot of things that, you know, NASA cannot do, these government organizations cannot do, a lot of restrictions and all. And also, more people work together, then you better things happen. So ISRO is doing also well. But again, ISRO in the beginning, if you think about ISRO actually in the beginning, the main charter of ISRO was to develop the communication infrastructure for the nation. All this satellite communication, all the satellites are launched, like INSAT system that you know, they're for communication and all, they are actually done by ISRO. NASA does not do that, because all these communication satellites in the US are done by private companies. NASA does not provide those, because our focus is to develop these rocket technologies, then the scientific instruments to do science. So that is the primary, you know, charter that we have. So all these organizations, they have different charters, but you know, the ISRO is actually more and more now spending time in terms of the scientific exploration. you like going to Moon, going to Mars, you know, Chandrayaan mission, Mangalayaan mission, and more, and some astrophysics missions as well. So we are doing more and more. That is a great sign, because if you do more of science, then you will get to develop, you know, new kind of technologies to do new science. So that is the good thing that is happening. And you should, all of you should go and ask your, you know, prime minister and others to spend more money on ISRO and other research areas. So that will give more opportunities to all of us.
Okay, sir, thank you. The next question is, do you have any suggestions on finding collaborators for projects or papers or competitions outside your college?
So I first part I missed it because of the audio broke up. Can you repeat the first part?
Do you have any questions on finding collaborators for projects, papers or competitions outside of your college?
Okay, after my college or after my NASA, you know, there are two things, right? So for us in NASA, we are open to collaboration, but you know, there are a lot of difficulties when you are trying to collaboration, because across the nations, there is something called ITAR, international, you know, that, you know, trade, what information I can give you, what information I cannot, I'll have to get clearance. So that prevents sometimes about collaborative issues, but we are very much open to collaboration, because we feel one of the when you all work together, that's when we are successful. In terms of my college, as I said, we did not have any collaboration or anything. We did not have many projects to do when I was in college. So we just had the, you know, we did not do all kinds of stuff. But nowadays, you should, you know, that opportunity is there. So if you want to collaborate with someone, you should contact people, might not be from your college. Contact them, you know, and ask them. In Bangalore itself, you are in Bangalore, there's so much of resources. You can actually do a lot of things. So again, as you know, since I got this question, maybe I should also do it. Tell you a little bit in a broader sense. I always tell people, you know, go out for coffee. Okay, not now because of COVID, but after COVID is gone, you know, find a friend, go out with your friends, drink coffee, tea, whatever you like, or cold drinks, and meet them. And it need not be from your same area of expertise, on your same department. Find people who are not working in your department. Go for coffee with them and talk to them. And, you know, in general talking, at the sometimes your subject matter will come up, you tell what exactly you are doing. In the process, you'll get a different perspective. I do every day. Since I became a graduate student here, every day at 3 o'clock, you'll find me outside drinking coffee with a bunch of people, but from all different backgrounds. I don't drink coffee, I drink tea, but that is different. You'll be finding they're from all different backgrounds, not necessarily they're working in my area. We talk about politics, we talk about soccer, we talk about cricket, we talk about everything, all the problems in the world. Sometimes we talk about our work as well. I tell, okay, this is what I'm trying to solve, and I'm stuck. And then someone who is not even in my area, they will start thinking from another area, another perspective. And you know what? In the process, I have a lot of patents in my name. Quite a few of those patents happened because the discussions we had in that coffee table. We were discussing about something, and then someone said, oh, maybe this is a good idea. Then we got said, okay, let's do one thing. You do this part, try to solve this part, I'll try to solve this part. And at the end, if something works out, we'll build something and we'll measure and see what happens. From there, a new component came up, and new ideas came out, and then we filed a patent, we got it. So quite a few of them actually came out through that. So I urge you all to do that. You know, this is very, very valuable to go out, meet with your friends, talk to them, talk about your work. Person is maybe doing civil engineering. It doesn't matter. Tell them what you are doing. Make them listen to your problems. That will help you.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. The next question is, what do you do in your free time and do you have any hobbies?
Okay. Let me tell you what I did today. In the morning, so it's now, this talk started at 7 a.m. here for me, 8:30 p.m. for you all, it was 7 a.m. for me. I woke up at 4:30. At 5 o'clock, I went out for a run. I ran 10 kilometers in 1 hour. So I came back at 6 a.m. I shaved, showered, and then I'm here in front of you, drank a cup of coffee. That's all. So nowadays I run because taking care of your health is very, very important. So do not neglect that aspect. Find something that you can do. I used to play soccer all my life. As a graduate student here, I actually played soccer, that is football. Even up when I was working in the last couple of years also, I used to play soccer in a club here that used to be play every Wednesday in the night. So I used to play there, and people from all over the world in those soccer team, Brazilians, you know, Argentinian, people from England, all great soccer players. And I'm not that great, and I was small compared to them. But still, I played cricket. I like music. I actually listen to a lot of music. I cannot sing that well, but I like Indian music very much. And then I watch movies. I write sometime. I think I can write, but I don't know. I write in Bengali. I try to write short stories. So yes, you'll have to have some hobby. Otherwise you should not be thinking about your work all the time. And I actually read a lot not necessarily reading about my work related stuff. I read a lot of newspapers. I'm a political junkie. I am a sports junkie. You can tell me about any sport, what is going on around the world. Maybe I know a little bit about them because I read those. I follow politics of all different countries. My wife gets mad at me sometimes because I tell her, okay, you know, this is what happened in Argentina recently. And say, why do you care? Why do you care about what is happening in Argentinian politics? So it is just my nature. So I read a lot of newspaper in the night.
That sounds so fun, sir. So next, what are your go-to places when you visit India, and what do you miss back from home?
Okay, I miss a lot of things from home. I miss food. I am a food junkie. I like good food. I really like good food. All kinds of, I experiment, I cook. Yes, one of the things I forgot to tell, I actually cook. I like cooking. My wife is a vegetarian and I'm a Bengali. Bengalis are vegetarian between two meals. So most of them. So I actually like cooking, and then I miss good food. When I go to India, I actually, the pre-COVID days, I used to go 3 to 4 times a year minimum. I know many of my friends, they go once in 5 years, but last year, 2019, I had gone 5 times to India. Mostly I go to meet my parents because they are getting old, and family. Family is very, very important to me. And then I actually go to many other places. I am a BL visiting chair professor at Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore. So I go there and spend at least 1 week when I go, 1 to 2 weeks, not at a stretch, but in chunks I spend there. And I also go to many other places because always people when come to know that I'm traveling, they will ask me to go and give a talk. So I go to many places, IITs, Delhi, Kanpur, Kharagpur, and many places, Bangalore, Cochin, and you know those things I do. So what I try to do is I go home and then from there make a small short trip to give a talk, because I feel it's very important for me, whatever I have learned, so that if I can talk to people, that will be my way of giving something back. You know, so if someone asks me, I do not know how to say no. That becomes a problem sometimes. And so I land up spending a lot of time doing all those and get, I get to hear a lot from my family members because of that.
Yes, sir. So I guess this question most of them will have. How to bag an internship in NASA being an Indian, and what are the prerequisites?
There is no prerequisites. You can apply. NASA actually has an internship program even for international students. However, there are only 100 seats. So we can only take at NASA wide, all wide, you know, NASA has a lot of different centers. Across all NASA centers, we can take only 100 international students for internships. So of course, people are applying from all over the world. So it's very difficult. But still, we do. There are no prerequisites. You know that if you apply, and then if you just see a few things, and then we select people based on that. So see your background, what your interest, whether there is interest matches with what we are doing at different places, and accordingly we actually choose them. So you should go and look into that. Just do a Google search on NASA internship. You'll find the reason we take only 100, that is not because of NASA, that has been imposed on us by United States State Department. They have said we can only, because majority of the internships are for US who are in the US, not necessarily US citizens, but who are in the US. But again, we are open to take internship students from outside as well, but with only 100 maximum.
Yes, sir. Thank you. So the next question, what do you think young professionals are lacking, and any piece of advice you'd like to give them?
So I don't think young professionals are lacking anything. I don't think you guys are lacking of anything. That, you know, you are all very bold and really, you want to take chances and all. I am so impressed by all these young professionals that I see always. So I think you guys are not lacking anything. What maybe the lacking is the opportunities that are lacking for you all. So if we give you all a challenge, you'll come out successful. Absolutely. That is, I have no doubt about it. So I always believe young professionals and students, you are the future, and we need to actually get you all, give you the opportunity. This onus is on us who are a little bit, advanced in our career. So we should encourage you all, because I always try to, in my team, you'll find a lot of young professionals, because I really believe in good mix of all these people. And also we have to treat them well. I always treat young professionals and students as colleague and equal. There is I never say that someone is work under me. Never, because that is not true. No one is working under me. We are all working together. So that way we have all equal footing. When in my team, at least, we have all equal footing. Maybe a young professional just out of college, doesn't matter. Your opinion is as much important as someone else's opinion. So I am really hopeful, and I really trust and believe in the capabilities of you all, because I think you can do. That is, impossibility is not an option for you all, I think, and you can do it. So that I really believe that.
Okay, thank you, sir. During tough times in your life, how do you keep yourself motivated and handle setbacks and failures?
Okay, that is a very good question. Setbacks and failures are part of our life, because if I know it sounds cliche, many of you maybe say, oh, my parents also say that, but this is true. That's what I feel, because it will come. Because if there is no one has been 100% successful all their endeavors, if they are, they're not trying hard enough, they're not trying to do something challenging. If you are trying to do something challenging, failure will come. And how I deal with it, everyone has to find a way in your own way of dealing with it. My thing is that I give myself 24 hours. Suppose something happened and something didn't work, something failed miserably. And then I give myself 24 hours to brood. You can brood, cry, do whatever you want. Don't talk to anyone, It's all up to you. But I tell myself that I have only 24 hours to give myself for that. And then I'll pick myself up and think what next. Because if you do this, and also in that 24 hours of brooding or crying, you should try to find out what went wrong. I always ask this, what exactly happened? If you think about it, what exactly happened? Where it went wrong? You actually get a very good clarity when you try to take a step back and retrace your path, what you have done. You get a sense that maybe this is what I have done, I shouldn't have done. And sometimes you find that you have done everything right. It might happen. Then you say that you should ask this question to yourself: did I try my best? If you find that you actually gave your best and outcome was not in your favor, don't blame yourself then. Then you move on, because you couldn't have done anything better. But most of the time we realize that maybe I could have done better. Maybe I could have done something differently. Once you identify that, that helps you a lot. So that's how I deal with it. But again, it is all very individualistic how you can deal with it. But you know, you should not, failure, you should take in your stride, because they teach you so much more than, you know, more than success.
Okay, thank you, sir. That was very insightful. So the next question is from Harshita. What is the selection process for recruiting engineers and astronauts?
Oh, astronauts is completely different. You know, astronaut is a very rigorous selection process. One of them, they actually choose for astronaut program people from different field again. You know, sometimes they choose scientists, sometimes they need people who has flying experience. You know, you'll find many of the astronauts that NASA choose, they have been, you know, in fighter pilots and others. So, but again, common man, like, you know, we also need them, you know, who have scientific background, engineering background, but they have to go through this, rigorous, because health is a big issue for that, your eyesight, you know, all the different things they want to see, and then rigorous training. So that is for the astronaut program. But for general, scientist, engineering positions, as I have been saying at the beginning, you know, we just see how, try to find out. It is not a actual science, because, you know, how do you know how someone will perform when they're hired? Because on a piece of paper, on your resume, you can write something, but when you come and you actually face a problem, how you are going to react to this, it is difficult to find out. But we still try to do as best as we can. We see how that person is going to work as a group, how that person thinks when we are talking, and we are talking about a problem solving. What is your approach of solving a problem? How you actually think about it? Where do you go? So we try to understand a little bit about that. And I come back to that key is the working in a group. This is very, very important. A lot of people are very individualistic. They actually just like working by themselves. It is not necessarily as bad, but, you know, as I was saying, that it's more important that if you are a group person, you actually like working with other people, that is a big added advantage.
Okay, thank you, sir. The next question is there any theory or technology NASA currently focusing on in order to develop instruments that travels faster than light?
No, we are not, because you know that if something, you know, all Einstein's theory, that, you know, if you are traveling faster than light, you are equal to mc squared. Those problem is there. So we are not even much closer to traveling to the speed of light. We are way, way behind. So traveling faster than light will come later. We'll have to find a way to how you can actually solve a lot of different problems. But we'll have a long way to go to reach those kind of speeds now.
Okay, so the next question is, who is your constant source of support and your role model?
Okay, role model. So my role model, couple of people, but I think my role model is my mother, because I have seen, as I mentioned about my life story, that we really struggled as a kid. But my mother, she did not have formal education. Her father had died when she was 1.5 years old. And, you know, and they were in Bangladesh, and the partition happened. They had to, both parents' family, they came to India from the Bangladesh side as a refugee, and, you know, stayed in a railway station and the refugee camp and all. They really struggle. But my mother is an amazing individual, and I am surrounded by very strong women, and I have a lot of respect. I have four sisters, My wife, she is an environmental scientist. She did a PhD here from University of California. I have a daughter. So you can see that I am really surrounded by amazing women. And, you know, my mother was very strong. She, the kind of, you know, mental strength that she had, otherwise it would have been really difficult to, you know, to raise six kids with that kind of economical situation. And all of us have done okay. All my sisters, they have, you know, bachelor's or master's degrees. My brother also is an engineer, and my wife is a scientist herself. So I look at my mom and get amazed that, you know, how she has done everything. And so she is my role model.
Thank you, sir. The next question is from Likita Madhav. If antimatter is made, will energy problems be solved? Will even space travel to other galaxies be possible?
So very good question. How do you make antimatter? That is the challenge, right? So theoretically, a lot of those things are yes, that what you are saying, that if we can make antimatter, like, forget about antimatter, we just think about fusion itself, that we have not have been successful doing the fusion. And then everyone has been saying for a long time that if we actually can do fusion, then it will solve our energy problem. So same way in the antimatter business, that how do you actually do that? How do you produce antimatter? And how do you, so those are the challenges. Yes, on paper, theory, a lot of work is going on, but that there are practical challenges that we have not overcome. Maybe you all will be able to solve that problem one day.
Yes, sir. Thank you. The next question is, what is your motto in life that you always follow, and one major takeaway you would like to give the audience?
My motto in life is that be a good human being. So that has been my motto, because, you know, if you think about as a human being, so there are so much of challenges around us. We generally run after some of us run after money, fame, everything. But at the end of the day, what matters is that do something for a human being. You know, your fellow citizens, your friends, your family around you. If you think about it, that is so important. Whom are we doing all these things for? You know, what do we do when you do something, when you build something, when you do all this? We are doing it for fellow human beings. So empathy is very, very important. So I always tell everyone, I don't know how that I have been successful or not, but my that journey is continuing. To be a good human being is more important than anything else. That has been my motto, to be as empathetic to others, to help in small way, whichever way I can, to other people. And so that drives me more than anything else.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for answering the questions patiently. I would like to ask the last question from Muktesh. What further breakthroughs are you expecting, just the way Katie Bowman and other scientists designed an algorithm which gave us the first image of a black hole? What are your thoughts on this?
That's a very good question. Katie actually works here at Caltech. She is an assistant professor at Caltech. And it was, you know, how it was done. So that is very interesting, because that they used telescopes. Called ETH, Event Horizon Telescope. It's actually a bunch of different telescopes all across the globe. And the frequencies that they used was 220 gigahertz, that is at close to terahertz frequencies. And my colleagues, my friends, they're involved in that those measurements. And also I actually developed technologies that the detectors that are used for those measurements in all these different telescopes called SIS mixers, superconductor insulator, superconductor mixers. And actually I developed those as well. So I am very much aware of what what has gone in. And actually, currently, we are developing the next generation because as we, you know, when you are looking at a black hole from that image that you see, you don't really actually see the black hole. There is no image of the black hole because it's dark, but we actually see what is happening surrounding it. And if you can image that, then you can, in a way, see the black hole. That's what happened. So we are actually developing the next generation of instrumentation to do that. I am actually involved. So yes, there is a lot of, a lot of cool stuff are out there to be solved, as I said, that before no one had seen the image of a black hole, but it was done because of coming together of scientists and engineers together and building, it's at the end is all hard work to build something, to get the data, to analyze painstakingly and develop some algorithm that Katie and others did. So yes, so your question is what is coming next in that way, in that area? We are developing the next generation of instrumentation to do that. And, discovery and all this stuff is so, it cannot predict really sometimes what we'll find. Of course, you try to do your research going in a certain direction, but many times it is unknown what will happen in future. So we can do is we develop what we think we can and then see where it goes. So it is a journey.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for answering all the questions patiently. There is a last question which sounds interesting. And after that, we'll move on for the fun time. It's asked as, can you share some current updates on X-ray pulsar-based navigation, Station Explorer for X-ray timing and navigation technology, Sextant in works by NASA?
So actually, it is that work is not as, how do I put it in a better way? That is exciting, but it's a lot of challenging to do, X-ray-based navigation. So right now, the kind of navigation that we do, one of the keys for navigation is the clock that we use. So recently, there was a cold atomic clock that was developed at NASA. Some of you must have seen that. But in the space, when you are doing the navigation, what we do currently, how do you navigate in space? There is no GPS, right? On your car, you have a GPS. You can go around and find out, through Google Maps. But in space, when you go, there is no GPS system going on. So what we do mostly is something called star tracker. So basically, we look at a star, known star, and we know the knowledge of that position of the star and how everything is moving, right? It is actually our systems. It is a very dynamic system. It's not a static system. As a result, a lot of calculations has to go in that okay, where something will be at certain point of time. So once you do all those stuff, and through that we do the navigation. But if X-ray navigation, as the question I think it who asked that question, I cannot read it. But some work is going on, but it is not really clear, that because making X-ray detectors for this kind of satellite platforms is not easy, because when you are saying that it will be a star tracker only, but you are trying to detect the X-ray signal that is coming from those stars and then trying to do your navigation. So right now we do optical domain, not in the X-ray, but of course, for your correction, and accuracy, X-rays will be better. But there are a lot of technical challenges in that area.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. That was very insightful. And you were so sweet, kindly and patiently answered all the questions. I'm sure the audience enjoyed that. Now we have planned something, a small fun time for you, and the audience can also take place in it. Thank you.
Yeah, let's begin our fun time. Audience can participate, and also, sir, you also can participate and find the answer. Let's move on to our first question, which is guess the gibberish. You have to just read the statement, which is in jumbled, and also below it, we have given a definition of the word, and you can just read the definition, and you can put a chat box, put your answers in the chat box. Let's move with the first question. Next slide, please. Yeah, the first question is here. The definition of the word is given below, and the above word is in a jumbled way. Just find out the word, what exactly it is.
I think all of them are answered correctly.
Okay, so I can see all of you have answered it correctly. So we'll see the answer. So the answer is comet. So let's go on to the next question. The next question is also against the gibberish. So Ruvini, are you there? Okay. So the next question is this. So try guessing. It's similar to the first one. So the description is given below. Latin word for cloud. So let's look at the chat box. Oh, yeah, many of them are answering it right. That's awesome. Okay, so that's nebula. So let's move on to the next question. So this is a quote which is told by a famous physicist, and he's like super popular, and sir also mentioned his name, and he's a person whom I really admire. So let's see if you can get this right. He says, I would rather have questions that can't be answered than answers that can't be questioned. So he's like super popular. Yes. Okay, I can see many of you have got it right.
Actually, Feynman was, as you all know, that Feynman was at Caltech, and he was a great physicist. And if you have not read, you should buy his three series books on physics called Feynman Lecture Series. They are really, really amazing, and a lot of videos about his teaching. He was one of the best teachers. But unfortunately, he passed away before I came to Caltech. But I actually used to sit in the same building where Feynman used to sit. So in that way, I used to feel elated. He was a great physicist.
Yes, sir, I totally agree on that fact, and I really love all the lectures, and he puts things pertaining to physics in such a simple way. So that really amazes all of us, and you know, anyone who is not interested in physics develops interest in physics. He has that ability. So yeah, that's the right answer. So we have the next question. Name the spacecraft used by Yuri Gagarin. Okay, I don't see answers coming up.
These all people are stuck. No.
Okay, all are googling, I guess, yeah. Nice. So it's Vostok 1. Yep. So let's go on to the next question. Name the galaxy whose black hole was captured by the Event Horizon Telescope. Like, it's the recent events. I think most of you will get it right. So the black hole's image which we captured was a part of this galaxy. So what's the name of that galaxy? The algorithm Katie Bowman developed. Okay.
Google is the best teacher, right? So I'm sure.
Yep. Neelakshi got it right. M87. So yes, so that's it from our side. So this is IEEE Student Branch VMS ITNM signing off. Thank you, sir. So Nidisha, take over.
Yeah. So thank you so much, sir. We are so happy that we got an opportunity. This is such a wonderful opportunity to get in touch with someone like you, a senior scientist from NASA. And we consider this to be a very blessed, I don't know how words to explain this, but all of us are very content that we could talk to you. And, I think most of us have cleared all our doubts. So thank you so much, sir. We are very grateful to you for joining us today. And thank you, sir. If you have any words that you want to tell.